see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
I was born in Richfield, Utah, on January the 18th, 1921. My earliest thoughts are very, very vague. I remember being up in the hills with Dad in a covered wagon on a fishing trip. I remember my mother fainting in the kitchen in Richfield, and her not being very well. And then I remember us moving to Salt Lake City, where I was raised practically by my grandmother, at least through the first grade. And then right after that, Dad was having a difficult time finding work and had gone to Death Valley and became employed with the Pacific Coast Borax Company in Death Valley Junction. Hence, we moved there and started to make a life on what we referred to there as the other side of the tracks, because there were tracks that separated the hotel and the better places to live from the places where the employees lived, which was the other side of the tracks with an outside toilet that was some 80 yards back of the house. So that's where we were, and we got used to using the Sears catalog in the outdoor toilet back there. And it was in that environment when Carlton had the problem where he set fire to a potato bag and we put it out from the school and that type of thing. And then Mother could not handle the heat of the Death Valley, and she moved to the Glendale, Alhambra area and took us kids with her. So we all lived there for maybe a year or something like that. And then finally Mother and Dad were separated and ultimately divorced. And Bonnie came into the picture in Death Valley from the Los Angeles area, and we decided to we actually had the choice of either to stay with my mother and do whatever she was going to do, or go with Dad and Bonnie back down to the Death Valley. And we three boys chose to go with Dad and Bonnie, and my sister Marjorie stayed with Mother, and they moved into the Alhambra area. And then back down in the valley, then we lived at the far end of the Armagosa Hotel, which was like a kind of a medical center, and Bonnie was the kind of a nurse practitioner for anybody that had to need to be a wound bounded up or a broken leg or something like that. We took care of that, so that was sleeping on the better side of the town. A little bit about the history in Death Valley. It was broken into two phases. The one phase when Mother and Dad were together, and the other phase when Bonnie and Dad were together. In the phase where Mother was there, we three boys did just about anything that we thought we wanted to do. We ran through the mill and raised hell worth there, and the people at the mill were complaining to Mother and Dad about us being mischievous and being over there and gonna hurt ourselves and all that kind of good stuff, which we really could have, but we didn't, thank goodness. During that time, while we ran around barefooted, and it was so damn hot, you could fry eggs on the car on the railroad tracks, and we used to walk the railroad tracks to see if we could beat the trains and all that kind of good stuff. So it was, we were wild kids during that phase, and did all of the mischievous things you had. We had 22s, and we would shoot at tin cans out by the toilet, and the spent bullets would roll up into the Mexican yards that were a half a mile down the road. So they were mad, and they came over and complained about shooting them, and all that kind of good stuff. During that time, we were in a one-room schoolhouse, which we had 35 to 40 kids and one teacher, and she taught all 7 grades. And frankly, I learned more in that one-room schoolhouse than I ever did after I got into high school, and it was broken up into classes. So it was a very good experience. And that was also broken up into two phases, the before with mother and the after with Bonnie, because I was there until through the 7th grade. It was the 8th grade that we moved to Bonnie's house in West Los Angeles. But during the time that I was with Bonnie there, why then we didn't have refrigeration. There was no air conditioning even invented at that time. So we had a cooler that was outside that we kept running water dripping over it, and the breeze blowing through the canvas was keeping things cool in the cooler. And we kept the milk and the butter and all that kind of stuff out there. And it was survival. And we were well-liked and we were well-mannered kids because Bonnie was a disciplinarian and we needed the discipline. And as a result, why the entire community was not happy when we left. They missed us, whereas before they would love to for us to be gone. But anyway, during that phase, it was, and I owe it all to Bonnie. She handled it properly, and it was good fun. Well, during the time that I was there, again living at the near the Armagosa Hotel, the daughter of the superintendent was called Mary Lillian Gower, and she and I became acquainted with each other, and she was my first date that we went together to the movie house, which was right next door to where we lived, and they had the projector, and we saw some kind of movies there, but that was the first date. And then after she then moved into the city, and her last name is Gower, and there's a street named after the Gower family in Hollywood. And then when we moved into West Los Angeles, I tried to keep up with her, but it was too far away. It was what you refer to as GU, or geographical undesirable, to try to keep up with her. But I've always had girlfriends. Hell, I can never be without one. It's like a job. I had a job from the time I was 7 years old. Vaguely, I remember the incidents where there was nobody home. I think mother had already moved to Southern California, to Alhambra area. Dad was working, of course, because dad never, it's all he did was work. He was really a hardworking man. So he was off working, and sis was with mother, and Ed and I were in school, and Carlton was alone at home, and he liked to play with matches. And so all of a sudden, while we saw this smoke coming from the porch, because you could see the house where we lived from the school where we were, and we saw the smoke coming from there, and so the teacher says, "You better get over there and see what's going on." And I ran down, and he had set fire to the burlap bag around his potatoes, and of course we put it out, and there was a lot of hullabaloo about him playing with matches, and we get a safety lecture and all the rest of the stuff that goes with it. But it was just one of those kid things that happens when you're left alone. And we weren't latchkey keys, we were just kids, free to do what we wanted to with no supervision. There was a swimming hole, as I remember it, about 25 miles from Death Valley Junction in Nevada, and I'm not sure where it was exactly. I think it was near a place called Pahrump. But it was a natural spring that you couldn't dive deep enough to get to the bottom of the hole. But it was a crystal clear hole, and that's since become a rendezvous for some illegal prostitution, as I've been told nowadays. But that was a fun thing to drive out to, and at that time we were underage without driver's licenses, but we had access to a Model T that we used to buy gasoline for. What the heck was it? It was less than a quarter. Would fill up the tank and would drive out there and go swimming. It was good fun. It was good fun, and that was a great spot. We visited that after we had been through school, and it completely changed. It was all fenced off, and you couldn't get close to it, and all that kind of good stuff. But that was a great hole. As I'd mentioned before, I was born in Richfield, Utah, and part of a Mormon family. So I was baptized when I became 12 or something like that as a Mormon. And the entire family is Mormon. And in southern Utah, if you were to drive through it even today, the place is filled with people that look like Sevys, with the same prominent feature, and there are a lot of Sevys and a lot of Wilsons through there. And so as Mormons, the genealogy is very prominent with that religion. And they had put together a book tracing back the who begat who, all the way back to a fellow named George Washington C.V. out of New York in the late 1800s, I believe it was. I'm not sure exactly what that timing is. And carried that all through. And the not part of that book, but from verbally, I was told, and I believe, that both of my grandparents, the grandfather Wilson and the grandfather Sevy, were both Utah state senators or representatives. They were in the politics, and both of them lost their tail during the crash in the 32 time frame, and the end result of that is that my dad is the only one of their kids that didn't get a college education. He stayed on the farm and stayed as a sheep herder. And he was herding sheep on the island in the middle of the Great Salt Lake at one point in time. I've always kind of resented that, but that's part of history now, that I've met the uncles and the aunts, and even though they were educated, they weren't anywhere near as rounded as my dad was, and they had maybe a little piece of land or something like that up in Utah. And Carlton and Ed and I took a trip back after I got out of service. We took a trip back up there and visited some of our aunts and the cousins and that type of thing. And we weren't impressed enough that we felt that we should move to Utah to join them in any kind of ventures at all. They still had kind of farms, and they did some fishing, and it was fun to visit with them. But life is what it is. You go with the flow there too, and go on. But that's a good part of history. Now, my son John, I gave that book to him because he was interested in the genealogy, and I don't know the details of it, but he became fascinated with it and went back and visited some of the sites in the New York and New England areas, and came up with some more history that dates the Sevy family back to an island called Sevy, which is off the coast of New England. And the rumor is that the population there dated before the flow of people came over from Europe, but they were there fishing and sending this stuff back to England and didn't come on shore because they would be killed by the Indians. So it's there's more history to it than going back to George Washington. But he knows more about that than I do, and maybe one of these days we'll get to do a thing on him. Dad's history was he was in the maintenance department in Death Valley, working for PCB, and it was maintaining the action of the mill and also all of the problems that were happening with the Armagosa Hotel. I mean, you could call it a janitor, but he was more than that because he took care of the electrical and the plumbing, and so he was really more of a maintenance engineer than he was any of that. And also at the mill, and at that time they were mining and refining borax for part of the refining of oil, and then they ran out of borax, so that the mill object was closed down, and Dad was then confined to working at the hotel and that type of thing, and then barbering on the weekend. And that's what happened, is that the phase out was there, and so Dad was thrown out of work and had to go look for it. I don't remember what the thing that he was looking for in Oregon, but there was some rumor that there was work available up there, and he went up there looking for it and couldn't find it. So then he came back down, and then he was part of the thousands of laborers that were picked up to work on Hoover Dam.
Five 5,000 men worked on the dam at the height of construction. Three shifts of men worked 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. But the job had just begun, and the most spectacular work was yet to come.
And I'm not sure what he did, except that he was a laborer, but he was always a skilled laborer. He was not never was a pick and axe type person, but he was a skilled laborer, and work commuted back and forth, and we would see him maybe once a month for a weekend that he would get. It was almost like being on leave with the Army, that he'd be able to come home.
Excavation was a monumental undertaking. More than 40 feet of rock, sand, and silt had to be removed from the now dry riverbed. Steam shovels dredged 500,000 cubic yards of material in preparation for pouring concrete. And on June 6, 1933, the first bucket of concrete poured into the form at the bottom of the canyon. For all the men, Hoover Dam offered work during the crushing Great Depression. Once the dam began to rise from the bottom of Black Canyon, those men would see they were part of something growing to historic proportions.
And that was Dad's history, pretty much, as he worked, and took care of family, and that's what I remember most about my dad, is that he was always working, a good hard worker. And I remember, you know, when we weren't disciplined by my mother, and she would tattle on us when Dad came home, and Dad would have to, you know, take the ruler and correct us, which was the wrong way to do it. And that never happened after Bonnie was in the picture. It was always, you know, if we were out of line and we got to the end of the leash, well, she snapped us back just as fast as anybody else would, which is what we needed. We needed the discipline. I think that she did a hell of a job walking in and taking over with three kids. I mean, there were four of us, but Sis was more staying with mother all the time, but taking over four or three rowdy boys is she had guts to do that, and I think they were all squared away pretty good. It turned out very good. I mean, I love Bonnie. Bonnie was a wonderful person, and after I was married to Lois and separated and moved back with them and up in the Palisades, why. We used to have long, long, long conversations about anything and everything he wanted to talk about. And so she was always part of my life. She was suffering from emphysema, and she and Dad moved out to the Desert Hot Springs. But Bonnie and I had a good relationship, I think. And I was sorry to see her not feeling well for the last several years that she was with us. From Death Valley, we moved to Southern California. In, you know, Death Valley's of course in California, but I mean to the Los Angeles area. Dad was working at Pacific Coast Borax Company, as I said, and doing barbering on the weekends. And then the job at the PCB petered out, and he went to Oregon looking for some type of work there that didn't work out. And we bundled up, Bonnie and we three boys bundled ourselves up and drove into West Los Angeles, where Bonnie owned a home, and moved into that home. And this was in, as close as I can remember, somewhere around 35 or 36. And that has to be broken down into two phases. One where we were with my mother, and later when we did it with Bonnie. So with my mother, Dad was left alone and was not taking care of us properly in Death Valley, because Mother and my sis were already in the Glendale, Alhambra area. And so we went to live with them. And Mother had taken up with Bud shortly right around that period of time. And we were living with both of them. And it was during that time that we were in this small house. I can't remember exactly where it was located, but it was close enough to the LA River that we were over there playing in the riverbed. And again, without supervision, we were living in the garage and sleeping in the garage and all that kind of good stuff. And it was then that Bonnie discovered that we'd picked up ringworm while we were playing in this LA River basin. And so she painted it with iodine and cured us of ringworm after we got back down to Death Valley. And then I've already covered kind of the story of us living with her on the better side of the tracks down there. And then when we finally decided to leave, Dad had left us looking for work in Oregon and couldn't find it. It was again still during the Depression. And then he found work with the Hoover Dam. And so we decided to move to West Los Angeles, where Bonnie owned the home, and moved there. And Dad was working at the Hoover Dam until that job was finished. And then he got a job working for the Los Angeles Country Club as a greenskeeper and fairway and keeper and that kind of stuff. So that move back was occasioned with the car loaded down to the gills and Bonnie and I sharing the driving coming back. And in those days, if you went 50 miles an hour, you were breezing. So we came back with that. And then we heard stories after we had left that after we had left there, that some burglars had come into Death Valley and cut the phone wires going into it and had robbed the store after we had left. We didn't see them at all, but we heard the story that we missed out on all the excitement because the place was thrown into darkness and the place was robbed by these people that were through there. So that was the move into the Los Angeles area. We were then living at Bonnie's house, she was active in the American Legion post. Her previous husband was in the service and was part of the American Legion, and she was part of the auxiliary. And then came about the opportunity to sell fireworks up on the corner of Wilshire and Sepulveda Boulevard. So we put together a stand there, and over the 4th of July weekend of, I don't remember the year that it was, but we sold a whole bunch of fireworks. We ended up siphoning enough off, we ended up with a new car out of it. And it was fun, And I think that Bonnie was always a good, good business head. And one other story about her. When we had previously been living in Death Valley, we always owed the company store. There was never a time when Dad got a full paycheck. If he was lucky to get any kind of a check, from the company because it went to the store first to pay off the balance that was there. And Bonnie took over, and that stuff stopped almost immediately. And so by the time that we left to come back, why, of course, we didn't know the company store anything, and we were saving money out of Dad's paycheck, which is shows you a big difference between the way households are run. Ed is a brother. Going back, he was the tough one to get along with when we moved from Death Valley to West Los Angeles, because he didn't want to be disciplined. I mean, Carl and I kind of fell into the thing that what is what, but Ed kind of quarreled with it. And so things would get too tough with Bonnie and Dad and Ed would move back over with Mother and Bud and stay with them until they couldn't handle it anymore, and they'd throw him out and come back over to live with us. And so he kind of vacillated back and forth between the two places until we were out of school. Being out of school is another thing, and maybe I'll be getting ahead of the story there, but Ed and I were in business together, and I considered him to be an absolute super salesman because he made the deal that we had with Colonial Mortgage that turned out to be, a way of life for 15 years or more, and that was in the later years. And so I can get into more of my feelings with Ed later on, but as growing up, why he was kind of difficult, but later on, why, of course, we were in business together for a lot of years. I don't know how he got his nickname Conk. You know, he was Carlton to me growing up. The Conk came about after Cookie got in the picture. I think that it was something to do with how she got her name. I think it was almost happened. I always felt it happened simultaneously, that she got Cookie and he got Conk, and that's the way that it was. But Carl and I were always arm-in-arm brothers, and we were both towheads, kind of blonde kids, and where my sister and Ed were both dark-haired kids. Carl and I are both Capricorn, if that means anything, and we kind of glued together because we understood where each of us was coming from most of the time, and went with the flow, Ed would never really go with the flow with anything if he didn't care for it. Why, he would balk and quarrel and all the rest of the stuff. But Carl and I have always been in love with each other and always will be. Well, Sis, of course, was a kind of an absentee sister. In that she was living with Mother all the time. And so she was never a sister's sister during the growing up phases. And then she married Art, and he was a fireman with the Glendale Fire Department and was injured in a fire, and had one hell of a time getting his pension that he was rightly deserved. But it took years of fighting through the courts and that kind of stuff before he finally got it. But it caused them to move away to places where he could find work that wasn't strenuous on him. And so they moved up into Oregon. And they were in Southern Oregon at the time that I was in Portland, Oregon, with a loan company up there. And so I would visit them occasionally, and we would, Marge and I would go hunting mushrooms. And she knew every mushroom that was grown in that area and could go out and pick those, and then always had a mushroom soup or mushroom stew, something on the back of the stove. So we had a good relationship that way all the time. Ed and Marge were closer in our adult years because Ed was able to travel more, or wanted to travel more, and Sis was up, and after they left Oregon, they moved down to the Petaluma area, And Art became involved with Texaco Oil and ended up having the distribution of the lubrication products for Texaco for all of the farming equipment and logging equipment, and would carry his truck out to them and lubricate the tractors and the trucks and that kind of stuff on site. And then he ended up with a string of Texaco filling stations along the Russian River. And I think at one time he had between 6 and 9 of them. And the Russian River, of course, used to flood about every 2 years, and so he would have flood problems during that time. But it was all very good for him. And they lived in Petaluma for, I think Sis just put the house up for market after living there almost 50 years. And she's just moved into a retirement community. And after Art passed away, he had a heart attack, and they said that he plugged up his veins from eating the good cheeses that were always made in Petaluma. But he wouldn't give up the cheese. And on their 50th wedding anniversary, Gloria and I were up to Petaluma visiting them on that one. And so we were you know, giving him trouble about eating the cheese again. And he says, "Well, if the right hand don't get you, the left one will." And that was his theory on life. And he ended up with a stroke and was in a wheelchair for 1.5 years, was just taking care of him before he passed away. And now that's been 25 plus years ago. So, and Sis is now, she's older than I, she's 2 years older than I, so she just had her 87th birthday and is just moved into the retirement community. And her boys, who when they're young, were younger, were almost duplicate of Ed and Carlton and myself in look-alike, because we had pictures that you could hardly tell us apart. But Sis has always been there, and I talked with her. She just got on the email, so it's the first time that she's been there. So I emailed back and forth with her, and she took up painting with oil paintings of flowers and this type of thing, and just very good at it until it became toxic with the oil, and she had to switch to watercolor, and she's now doing watercolor with that. But she's a love. She's a gorgeous woman, and you know, one of my favorites. We went to university high school, and at that time, university high school was a school that had 6 grades in it. It ultimately became a 3-grade high school with a separate junior high school, but it was 6 grades at the time that I went through it. And Ed also was through it there. And then I think Carlton went to the junior high school before he went to university high school. And yeah, university high school, this was still during the Depression time. And backing up just a little bit, Dad had gotten a job with the building the dam at Hoover Dam, which is outside of Las Vegas. And so he was absent quite a bit of the time, but we were being well taken care of by Bonnie. She was making sure everything was going right. But during that time, things were kind of tough, and Carlton and Ed and I also went into food lines to get donated breads and canned food from Argentina, where it was coming from, in order to subside. And we started raising chickens and rabbits at the place in West Los Angeles. And when we got into high school, the clothing allowances were still pretty short, so we decided that we boys were going to be in the junior ROTC, which University High School offered, which was okay, because then we had uniforms supplied by the government for Monday through Thursday, and had our civilian slacks on Friday, which worked out real good. Well, I became very, very enthusiastic with the ROTC, and it was you were either in ROTC or you were in some kind of athletics. And I wasn't as athletically inclined as I maybe could have been. But anyway, I enjoyed the military and so stayed with it. And when I was appointed a sergeant, which was the first rank, I won the best squad competition. And then I became a first lieutenant and won it for the next group. And when I graduated, I was the lieutenant colonel in charge of the entire battalion, with all of the refinery that goes with it. And I had, you know, I was a big man on the campus. Really, that's what it turned out to be. University High School was where we walked from West Los Angeles to the school. And rain or shine, snow or not, of course, it's snow, that never did snow there, but we always used to walk. And finally, I got my first car, which was a Model T. And I got it from somebody who was a mason, paid $8 for the automobile, ended up overhauling the engine in it, and I had a ball with that. That was a lot of fun thing. And then I found enough tools on the bottom of it, underneath it, that we took and sold it for $10 through, I don't remember who the heck bought it, but we sold those tools there for enough to pay for the car and drove it. And we were driving that car during our major, major rainstorm in 1938 that just about flooded everything from the LA airport all the way up to West Los Angeles, and most of the intersections were inundated with flood water. And Ed and Carlton and I were in this Model T, and we would run around and tow people out of the deep water of the intersections where their cars were flooded out. It was a lot of fun. And that was my first automobile, and then the later one I didn't get until after I'd graduated from school, and it was a Plymouth. But the during that time, I was spending most of my time being active in ROTC, which was a good military bearing. And as I'd mentioned before, I was the lieutenant colonel in charge of the entire battalion, which would be three major companies, and something like 250 students were involved in it. And my adjutant was a fellow named Jerry St. Peter, who was killed in the first 60 days of the World War II as a pilot somewhere. I never did get a chance to know him too much from that, but my 25th reunion, the way I learned that he had been shot down shortly after that. So that gave me the foundation. I always was told that I had a very military bearing, that I walked standing straight up and all that good stuff. So I knew when the war started that I had to be a commissioned officer. So I applied to all the places in the world where they had cadet training, from the Coast Guard to the Navy to the Air Force wasn't in at that time. The Army Air Force was there. And none of them would take me because I didn't have college background. So I was not picked up with that. I had a girlfriend there that she became appointed as the cadet lady in chief. I forgot the name for it, but at the ball, why she was there with me, and in a full gown and regalia, and of course that was during the time we wore pink slacks and wore boots and a sword and all that kind of good stuff. So it was showtime, and I did well with it. I had a ball and I liked it. It's called the Reserve Officer Training Corps, and it's a junior element of it. The senior element of Reserve Officer Training Corps is in college, and once you graduate from that, you become a second lieutenant. For a junior ROTC, it had no you got nothing from it except for the education and the. But we were drilled by a real captain from the Army, was in charge of the ROTC, and we wore uniforms and did close order drilling and did drilling with rifle drilling to display our accuracy with that. And we never did do any shooting. You had to do some sighting and mock shooting to learn how to use the rifle and that type of thing. But most of it was drilling and command and the military protocol. It was all taught, and the and particularly the highlight of close order drilling, and then of course there were examinations on all of that, which I excelled at, or I wouldn't have become the senior officer. Then, looking back at that, when I was out of school, the war came along.
Berlin claims continued gains in the Ukraine.
President Roosevelt eliminates export of motor fuel and oil to Japan.
On December the 7th, 41, which was a Sunday, I was busy ice skating at the Sonia Haney Marina, or ice skating rink, near the suburbs of UCLA in the Village. There, I don't even know if that rink is still there or not, but that's what I was doing at the time that Pearl Harbor was bombed.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring you this important bulletin from the United Press. Flash, Washington. The White House announces Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
Army nurse Monica Conter.
I rushed late for duty, as we'd had quite a party the night before. I heard some planes real low. I turned to some of the patients who knew aircraft and said, "My God, it's the Japs." They laughed and said, "Don't be silly, it's maneuvers."
Ensign George McCartney Hunter on the USS West Virginia.
Suddenly, the general alarm sounded, and simultaneously, a terrifying explosion rocked the ship. Pearl Harbor was a devastating sight. Forward of the West Virginia, the Oklahoma was bottom up. Astern of us, the Arizona was a mass of flame. High-altitude Jap bombers flew over in perfect formation. They came in waves.
Sailor John Shannon.
The planes passed right overhead with their machine guns going full. There was no mistaking that big red rising sun painted on the wings and tails, nor was there any mistaking the bombs, torpedoes, and machine gun bullets.
The Pacific Fleet's aircraft carriers are at sea and escape damage. But in less than 2 hours, the attack on Pearl Harbor kills more than 2,400 men and knocks out 8 battleships. 10 hours later, American bases in the Philippines are attacked, and 103 aircraft are destroyed.
No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory.
The following day, with one dissenting vote, Congress approves the declaration of war against Japan. 3 days later, Hitler declares war on the United States.
and was absolutely shook. And of course, I knew that I had to be in the military, and I knew that I had to be commissioned. So as I might have mentioned before, I went to all of the services to try to get in to some kind of officer training school, and they were not available. So in the meantime, I went to work for North American Aviation. And at the time we were manufacturing the P-51 and the B-24, or B-25. And I ended up being a surface control inspector for for both of those airplanes, both surface control and hydraulic. And as an inspector, I was checking the installations to make sure that they met the requirements and that type of thing. And it was during the working of that I met Lois. And she and I became lovers and ultimately married. But I was actually drafted from there, drafted because I couldn't enlist any place, or I wouldn't enlist any place if I couldn't become an officer. So I was drafted from there into the Air Force, or into the Army Air Corps section, and transferred immediately to Atlantic City, New Jersey for boot training. So I was housed on the boardwalk in Atlantic City in one of the hotels, and did my boot training on the sand. And so we ended up marching on sand all the time, and that's some of the strenuous exercise in the world, is to try to do close order drill and marching on sand. So in any event, I was there. And one little side thing is that the rumor came out is that on Easter Sunday, the place was going to be inundated with all of the babes from New York and Washington. We're all going to be flocking into Atlantic City. And man, we in the service were licking our chops waiting for them to show up. Well, OLHS ends up with a 3-day German measles 2 days before they showed up, and I spent the Easter Sunday in the hospital and didn't get involved with any of the girls from Philadelphia or New York or Washington, D.C. So, but from there, I was offered the chance to take a test to go to a school in Transylvania College in Kentucky to get what would be the equivalent of the college credits that I needed in order to go to some kind of cadet school. So I passed the examination for that and was shipped off to what the hell was the name of the place? It was Transylvania College anyway, in a suburb of Louisville, Kentucky. Dyersburg, I think it was. And went to that, and then was shipped to San Antonio to take examinations for some kind of cadet training. And I took those examinations, and I was qualified to become either a pilot, a navigator, or a bombardier. And I could make my choice of any one of those three schoolings to go to. Well, I knew that if it was in a book, that I could pass it, and I could become an officer. I didn't know if I was coordinated properly to be to actually graduate as a pilot. I didn't know that. And I didn't like the idea of sitting over a bombardier someplace. I liked the idea of doing the mathematics and that type of thing that the navigation required. So I took it. So I went to the Wellington Air Force Base, which is a suburb of Houston, and was based there and went through cadet training. Part of that was a solo flight in a light aircraft, which I did, and the rest of the time it was doing celestial navigating training, where both for dead reckoning and also for celestial shooting the stars and that kind of stuff. Finally graduated and was commissioned as second lieutenant from there. Immediately transferred to a relocation center, and that was someplace in Tennessee, if I remember correctly, that some Air Force base there. Went home on kind of a rotation thing. You got about 10 days leave to get home to see the family, and then assigned back to this base. And I met a friend of mine when I showed up by train at this place, and I was a day ahead of time. They were supposed to report the following morning. We got there the night before. And so we were issued sheets and pillows and that kind of stuff for the bunk, made up our bunk, and we were free. So we went into town and did that. The next day we start through the processing and go through all of the military processing. The end of it was to be assigned our bunk and the bedding. Well, we already had that, so we figured we were done. So we shoved off and went back into town. The next morning we were called on the carpet, because what we didn't realize is after the being checked out with the bedding, we had to sign the morning report. We didn't sign the morning report, so we were considered AWOL. Well, the man in charge of that group was just absolutely incensed, and he told us that we were going to be shipped out first and get over to the service and get our heads blown off, because he didn't want us screwing around his place. So, which turned out to be a lucky break, because we were shipped out the next day and we got in to be 17s, when we learned that most of the other guys that were shipped out were assigned to B-24 groups. And there was a big, big difference between the B-24 airplane and the B-17, and it turned out to be a very fortunate thing. So we were sent from there to finally ended up being in Newfoundland and picked up a new 17 to fly it to Italy. And the night before, we were up all night long studying the stars because we're going to take off on a night celestial mission to fly the Azores. Well, a storm blew in and we took off at 6 o'clock in the morning, so there were no stars out to shoot. So we headed south down to the Azores, and so I shot the sun at 11 and at noon and at 1 and moved the lines back to each other, so I knew about 1:30 where I was at 12 o'clock, and made an adjustment and split the runway at the Azores, which is just a little dot of speck out in the ocean. And we landed there, and then from there we went over to North Africa and landed there, and a truck ran into the wing of the airplane. So we were grounded there for over a week while they sent for Boeing to come out and take a look at the B-17 to see if it was still airworthy. And it was, they patched it up, but it gave us a week to crawl around in Marrakech. And so we learned where that was, and then we took off and went to Egypt, and then on up to Foggia, where we were stationed. And during all of that time, I did all of the navigation by dead reckoning and with making the adjustments and that kind of stuff, and split hairs all the way. It was just absolutely boom, 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 without any kind of a hesitation. And my ETAs were off as much as 10 seconds and that kind of thing. I was good at what I was doing. And so when we flew from Cairo across Sicily and into Italy, we ran into a thunder and storm in the front. You couldn't go over or around or under it. It was just awful. So we were diverted and had to land in Bari. And landed in Bari, which is on the east coast of Italy. Landed there and spent overnight. The next day we were within an hour flight time. It was no more than to the base we were going to. But the pilot decided to let everybody on the airplane fly the airplane. We didn't hold a heading for nothing. And within about 30 minutes or so, we'd been all over the sky, and I didn't know where the hell we were. So I made him fly out to the spur on the east coast of the boot and picked up a road and a railroad and flew it in and found the base that we were after. But I was so lost, I had to go find some place that I knew where I was to come in and do it. And I was embarrassed as hell over that, but no one ever knew about it. It was something that I knew, but that was a fun thing. So we landed in Foggia. If you were to draw a line from the spur to Naples, and about halfway there, right in the middle of it, would be where Foggia is located, right in the middle of the plains of Italy, which is where all of the agriculture was done. And so we ended up with probably something in excess of 25 airfields in that same general area. I know that, you know, that England had probably 50 stacked into the same area where we had 25. But you could almost tell the airfields where the B-24s were by the column of smoke, because they almost invariably, one of them would not make it off the ground. It would be just not airworthy enough to get off the ground and would crack up at the end of the runway, and there would be the column of smoke from the from that airplane. So again, it reinforced the fact that I was lucky to be flying a B-17, because there was never anything like that had happened. The B-17 to me was an absolute charmer. It was just a great airplane. And having worked in the aircraft business, you know, that I knew that I was in something that I was going to be safe in. I mean, my favorite plane was the P-51 and the B-25 and the B-17. And all three of those aircraft had marvelous records in the war. They just were absolutely outstanding. And the 17, we referred to it as a flying kite, and because it just absolutely would not come down. And on a couple of missions that I had, we lost engines, and the one time we came back with only two engines back over the Alps, coming back into landing, and another time lost one engine, and it was just comfortable. I mean, and we flew such not good, nice, tight formations.
It takes all of a pilot's strength to keep a 30-ton fortress in tight formation. But the formation is the bomber's best defense against enemy fighters.
And we were only past that with the fighters one time in all the flights that I made, because most of them had B-24s in the air, and they'd take on the 24s and leave us alone. But we would fly just overlapped, the wings practically overlapped. And you couldn't do that with a 24 because it was too cumbersome to fly. But with a 17th, it was like a fighter pilot. I mean, a big fighter pilot, a fighter aircraft, because you could fly just real tight and do any damn thing you wanted to with it, and the plane would respond. I loved the plane, still do. Within 10 days, I'd already flown five missions out of Foggia over the targets in Yugoslavia. And at that time, we were hitting Vienna and the Bleckhammer oil fields and some of the places in Czechoslovakia were the main targets. But I was a veteran at the end of 10 days with five missions under my belt. It was bang, bang, bang. And of course, I started off being a kind of a backup navigator. I had to keep track of where we were, and flew off a lead, and then almost immediately was pushed into a lead position, which meant that I had to leave my crew and work with the crew that was in the lead aircraft, and then follow the plotted course. And then went from there to planning. And planning was a very interesting thing that I don't know if everybody knew about that, but we would receive a teletype from home office in the Air Force of where our target was. And the target was always around noon. And we made the target, as I understand it, around noon so that the people being bombed would know that we would be bombing the factories and that kind of stuff during the lunch hour, and the employees could duck out and go to lunch and hide in shelter someplace during the time that we were bombing the factories. That's what I was told. And the end result is that we would be bombing, our bombs would be away between 12 and 12:30, you know, and you'd have the whole wing would go over, and periodically you'd be bombing the targets during that time. And on the planning, we would know that our bombs would be away at such time, and you'd have to go back to the initial point. And then over the map, we knew where all of the flak guns were located. And so you would draw a line to where you were not exposed to the anti-aircraft fire from the ground. and that would be the route that you'd take. So it was never in a straight line from there back down to the coastline or something. It was always a jagged route in order to avoid these flak situations. And then finally down to the rendezvous point near our airfield, and then the time that it took to spiral from there down to takeoff and back it up to a breakfast and back it up to how long it would take for the guys to be awakened in order for them to get to breakfast, to get to the airport, to get to takeoff time, to circle the rendezvous, to make the flight, and back it all down. And that was the detail that we would be involved in planning a bombing mission, which, you know, I found fascinating that I could even do that, you know. I don't know that I could do it to now, but that was all done with a circular computer. It wasn't done with any of the calculating stuff that we have now and drawing on the map, and so you'd have the headings all plotted and all that type of thing. It was kind of interesting. And when I went over there, we were scheduled to fly 50 mission credits, and that usually would figure out to be somewhere around 22 to 27 sorties, a sortie being taking off and over the target and coming back. And then they changed it to where we had to be 35 sorties because they were running out of people. We just had to be there longer, which turned out that you got a 2-mission credit if you're above the 45th parallel, which it turned out that I ended up with 35 sorties and 57 mission credits. And during that time in November of 1944, over Yugoslavia, while I was hit, I was helping the Navigator find a target, and I was going back and forth like this, and we had a helmet on, but every time you moved your head, the flaps would come in front of your eyes, so I took it off and threw it aside. So I was over the top of my bombardier looking to where the target was, and he finally found it, and he says, "I got it," and I turned this way, and a hole opened up right where my head was, and instead of hitting me between the eyes, it grazed me on the right arm. So I didn't get the Purple Heart because I wasn't hospitalized and I didn't bleed, but I was bruised from here clear up to here with that mother. And then looked around to see what was going on, and the whole flak was so intense that the whole wing was just scattered all over the sky. There was nobody following any leader at all. So we took over and called everybody in, and we started. I gave him a heading, "Let's go here." And so we had to navigate back through the flak positions and gathered these guys in.
Bombs away.
Gathering in 28 airplanes that flew off of our airplane to get back to the base and brought it in. And a result of that, why they gave me the Distinguished Flying Cross for doing that little job. right after that, the Germans had developed a rocket or some kind of artillery shell that could home in on the radar part of the navigation unit of the lead airplane. And I said, take me off a flying lead, baby. I want to finish my duty and get the hell out of here. And so they did. So I flew wing for the last five missions, I think it was. I wasn't flying lead. I was flying off on somebody's wing. And so I'm here, you know, as a result of that. I ended up on two leaves during this course. The first one was to the Isle of Capri, which I felt very fortunate to be able to get over and see that, because I went through the Blue Grotto that was absolutely marvelous and stayed in one of the luxury hotels. And the luxury hotel had a bidet in it that I had never seen or heard about. And we really had a hoot with that. We were washing our feet in it because we had no idea what the hell the thing was for until after we got back to the base and people started telling us what it was there for. But that was fun. And then after I'd finished the tour, after I finished my missions, then I was assigned for a trip up to Rome. And looking forward to that little gig, because we thought, man, we'll get some of those dolls up in Rome, and then get up there, and we find out that they couldn't take any of the girls beyond the first floor, because a couple of weeks earlier than that, some colonel had thrown one of the girls out of the third story window, and so they restricted us taking any girls away from the first floor. But anyway, the Foggia women, you'd go down and see them, and there were no men around, you know, number one. All of the men were in the service somewhere. The Italian men had all been conscripted or something like that. And it seemed like all of the women in Foggia were farmer types. They really looked like a sack of wheat with a couple of oranges thrown at them and hardly any waistline at all. They were just not attractive. And then when we finally got up to Rome, why, they looked halfway decent up there. They looked like women. But there was just no comparison between one and the other. It's almost like comparing the women in Los Angeles with the women in Philadelphia. Really, it's just about, except now the women in Los Angeles are getting to be just as bad as the women in Philadelphia. I'm not pleased with what I'm seeing out here this time. And I'm spoiled with good-looking women with good shapes. When I was in cadet training, we came back from flying and I was starved. And all of a sudden there was this great big serving of steaks and a nice gravy. And man, I hadn't had steak for a while now. Geez, that is marvelous. So I took three of these big steaks and they turned out to be liver. And I can hardly eat liver. And the rule there was, take what you want, but you have to eat what you take. So everybody was there watching to make damn sure that I finished off those liver steaks, and it must have taken me 3 hours to finish dinner that day. It was just absolutely awful. By the time it was over with, coming back home, I refused to fly home. I had the option by this time I was a first lieutenant, And I had the option of flying home or coming home by boat. And I took it coming home by boat. And that was a long, torturous ride too, but it was almost as if I thought flying was, I just didn't want to do any more of it at that time. It seemed like it was too dangerous to me. Came into Boston, and then took a train from there to California. And was discharged in California. Well, I actually came back on rotation. I came back to Santa Monica, and the war wasn't over yet in either theater, and I was being groomed to either go. I was had three choices to either go on to get into another navigation school where you'd be taught radar and and that type of thing, and be in grade, or I could go to pilot school in grade, or I could get out, because you got so many points for the length of time you're in, and for your theater ribbons, and for your, for your other decorations, and I had enough points that I could be discharged. And the war was getting close to being over in Germany, and I think, I'm not sure exactly when it was over there where I was, but in any event, I got out and went to work for a local loan company. And I think I was working for them when the war in Europe ended. The decision as whether or not to go to school in grade or to get out was, I really walked the beaches and argued with myself and argued with my wife Lois, and we did all kinds of searching, because I knew that the economics of it, that I was making almost $500 a month as a first lieutenant in the Air Force, and I knew that in the civilian life, $200 was about the maximum you could get any place. Between $150 and $200 was just about the maximum that was being paid anywhere. But I finally decided I'll take my chance, and Lois contributed to that too, because she didn't like the idea of my being gone and being away from her and all that kind of stuff. So I decided to get out. And so I did. So I was one of the first guys walking around with a ruptured duck. The Bronze Stars are part of the theaters of combat that you were in. And I was in North Africa and in the France and in the regular Southern European theaters of war. And those are then there were several battles within that that gave the Bronze Star. The oak leaf clusters on the Air Medal were given because of the number of flights. So I had the Air Medal in three clusters, and I had the Bronze Stars for the theater ribbons, as well as the Distinguished Flying Cross. So I had enough, what the hell did they call it? The fruit salad to, make it look good on my uniform. Carlton was shot down on his 10th or 13th mission, something like that. And really banged up bad. He's the one that suffered the war. I came out of it unscathed by comparison. It was just I got hit in the right arm, and so what? It was a bruise, but he really got banged up. And he was there in England, where the buzz bombs were buzzing over the hospital where he was, and he was in a full cast because of the damage that they'd done to him, and he couldn't get out of bed to be tied or nothing. It was they'd come around and try to put him someplace, but he was there with these buzz bombs, and they would shut off, and then you'd wait for them to fall, and they never knew where the hell they were falling. It was just kind of a random lob, and so you have no idea what was going to hit a hospital or hit a hotel or what a hit the ocean, and he had no idea where it was going to hit. And then, as I understand it, he was taken down to the dock, at least on one occasion, ready to get on board a boat to be brought back to the United States. And the submarine wolf packs were so heavy that they almost got him on board and then turned around and took him back to the hospital because it was too dangerous to get him loaded. So it's a... Carlin went through the war. I mean, he went through the war, and as far as I'm concerned, I just didn't, because God was watching over me, and I know when that piece of fragment missed my head and hit my arm, that the old boy had something else for me to do. It was that was just the way that I felt about it, and I still feel that way about it. That it was. I was blessed and being watched after for some reason that I'm not sure what it is. And maybe I will someday, maybe I won't. But Carlton fought the war, and he fought it for both Ed and I, because Ed was in the Marines and stationed in San Diego, and he had a nasal problem, and when he was flying this one time, he got congested and he couldn't clear his sinuses, and they couldn't stay up any longer because they were running out of gas, and they forced him down, and it forced him down, blew out his sinuses, and he had his sinuses and nose operated on, and that's why he ended up with a crooked nose. But that kept him from actually getting into combat. So his combat was an operation by the military that gave him the features of a crooked nose, which turned out to be a good feature, part of his charm. Lois and I were married before I went in the service. I had met her at North American Aviation, where we were both working. And during the course of time, she became pregnant. I think it was probably on some return leave from the service that happened. And she gave birth to John. At that time, we were living with her parents, and I wanted to move out. She didn't want to move out. And we just weren't getting along, and we separated and divorced. And then over time, we decided to get married again for the sake of John, to make sure that he had a father growing up. And by this time, I had been working with local loan company, had been transferred from Denver, Colorado to Roseburg, Oregon. And so we got married again, and she joined me in Roseburg and had John along. And that lasted for about a year, and then we found that we just absolutely couldn't make it. And so we were divorced again. I kept up with John as much as I possibly could, although it was very strained. But I paid child support from that point forward until he graduated from college and some after school at about 23 years old. So I ended up playing child support for 20 some odd years, which is all right. I mean, it was my obligation, and I did that. Back in that time, it was taught by both my mother and dad, by both Bonnie and my dad, that you shouldn't have intercourse until you were married. You should go as a virgin. And so during that time, of course, I was looking for dates and it's very difficult to be trying to push yourself off onto somebody and then tell them that you're not going to do anything until because you want to marry a virgin. But in any event, I was a virgin when Lois and I got married. And I've never regretted that. Because at that time, well, we were raised that, you know, if you don't sleep with somebody unless you're married to them. And I carried that philosophy for the next couple of marriages anyway. But after that, it kind of went by the wayside because everybody grew up. Lois was very bright and very ambitious, very hardworking girl, and really loved her son. That's for sure. Then I met Dorothy in Portland. Dorothy and I got married. And we got married before the 6 months that California required you wait after the divorce from Lois. And we got married early. We went across the river to Washington and got married, because it was okay with both Oregon and Washington to do that, even though it wasn't okay with California, with the understanding that on the following year, that when the legislature met in Oregon, that they would solemnize all the marriages of the people that did what we were doing, because a lot of it was being done. So anyway, that was done. Then after a while, we had an opportunity to adopt Greg. Greg had not been born at this time, but there was this young lady being transferred from the Midwest out to Oregon to give birth to the child that she was having with the young man in school that she wasn't married to. And we were nominated by the doctor to be the parents. And so we followed the last month or so of her pregnancy and followed through at the time that that she gave birth to Greg, why we were there to pick him up at the hospital, and we took him right from the hospital as our adopted son. Well, the attorney from that insisted that Dorothy and I get married again to offset the possibility that Greg could lose his inheritance by virtue of the fact that we didn't wait for the 6 months down in California. So we ended up getting married again. So that's what accounts for the multiple marriages. But nonetheless, it was just when there were circumstances that required it. And we remained together, both in Oregon, and then we transferred down to Southern California. And I got into the real estate business and ultimately into the mortgage business. And Dorothy and I began to grow apart, and we separated and got a divorce. And then she moved back to Oregon and took Greg with her. Dorothy was just a sweetheart of the world. She really was good. And God bless her. Well, she became ill. And couldn't handle it. There's a reason that she and I, and she, what I refer to as she didn't grow with me in the business world that I was trying to grow with, and she resisted getting involved socially with the people that I felt I had to be involved socially with in order to get ahead in business. Pat was the youngest lady that I had ever been married to, and we ended up starting having problems because I don't know if it's the age difference or whatever the case was, but I ended up bringing her back to Philadelphia after I started my association with Colonial Mortgage, and then brought her back down to California, and ultimately we just agreed that we were not going to be able to make it and separated. And then at that same time I was transferred back to Philadelphia with the company that ultimately bought the company that Ed and I had formed, and I was transferred back to Philadelphia as a manager of the 20 some odd offices that we had scattered all over the United States. Why I was doing the supervising of those and doing it from Philadelphia. About this time my interest rates started going through the roof, and the 70s when the real estate crash came, and we ended up closing a bunch of those offices, and Pat was just an absolute beautiful responding type person. She's the one that everybody flocked to when we were in public or with out with any type of people, and she could associate and communicate with babies all the way up to the heads of corporations. But privately, she was just absolutely impossible to stay with. I mean, she had a multiple personality that was tougher than hell for me to find. But she was gorgeous, and she was certainly a pleasure to be with. And you would call her a premium wife, you know, to show off with. No doubt about that. I was introduced by the president of the company to Gloria. And then Gloria and I were married. And she was Jewish, and I was not, but we were married by a rabbi and had a good marriage. And she worked in real estate, and I was in the mortgage business and had my real estate license. I was a broker since 1964 when I was working out in Southern California and selling some of Carlton's houses. And so I had that broker's license, and I needed it to be in the mortgage business, so I kept it in the mortgage business. And when we got, Gloria and I sold real estate for the James R. Gary Company and did very well. But in the meantime, while her two children that she had by her previous marriage were growing up, and the boy, Adam, not Adam, excuse me, Michael, had a couple of children, and they were, of course, Gloria's grandchildren. So every time came for us to take a vacation, why, Gloria hopped a plane and came back to Philadelphia to see her grandkids. And at some point in time, that got to the point of where we figured, well, let's move back to Philadelphia and it'll solve everything. So we ultimately moved back here. And we were both selling for the Roach brothers in real estate. And I finished up with the mortgage business. And then she contracted mesothelioma, which is a cancer of the lining of the lung caused by asbestos. And it usually has an incubation period of about 25 years, and we could never figure out how she became infected with it, where she was that she was exposed to it. But we kind of assumed that it had to have been back in California, where they used a lot of what we call cottage cheese on the inside of the ceilings. Then when they started cleaning that up, we knew that that had asbestos in it, and we could have been in a house or two that where that was still in the air, and it created that. Nonetheless, she had that and passed away. And at that time, we were living in at Pinecrest Golf Club, where I live at the present time, and we had known the lady that was going to become my fifth wife, Irene, who she and her husband owned a place called the Montgomery Inn, which was the place to go to eat in our neighborhood. It was really a marvelous place, and she and her husband had had it for 25, 27 years, something like that. And she had purchased a home in a townhouse at Pinecrest Golf Club, which is the, when Glory and I were back there, we had visited Irene at the restaurant, and she said, you should go over and take a look at this, which we did, and we fell in love with the property and with the house and bought a house there. Gloria was also a wonderful lady, and I was just sorry as hell to see her become ill, because she and I were loyal to each other. She was terribly loyal to her family, and she was a beautiful person to be with. And when she became ill with mesothelioma, there was a friend of the family, a man who was the previous husband of her daughter-in-law's mother, that became ill with the same disease at the same time. And he was a furrier, so we have no idea how he got mesothelioma at the same time. But the doctor said that he would, you know, that both of them were given 8 months to live, and if they didn't do anything about it. And he would refuse to do anything about it. He felt he'd lived long enough, and he wanted to be with his last wife anyway. And so he didn't do anything, and he was gone in 8 months, almost on the nose. And Gloria, of course, went through radiation and chemotherapy and the whole nine yards. And instead of being gone in 8 months, lasted for a year and a half. And during the whole year and a half, I took care of her. That was the agreement. That's all there was to it. So it was a good marriage. I was really shook up over that. I had known Irene then going back for maybe 25 years before, because Gloria's brother used to take us out to the Montgomery Inn when we were first back here visiting, and when I was first back here in the early 70s. So she was around, and by this time she was separated and divorced from her husband, and we started dating and ultimately got married. So she was my fifth wife, And there wasn't a big waiting time. Never was a big waiting time. It seemed like there was always another lady in the woods. As soon as I was finished with one relationship, it was off to another one, which was good and which was bad. But Irene was there, and we ended up having a big wedding. She had with her husband Herb had been in Germany. When Irene is from Germany, and Herb was in Germany during the war, and was a cook, and had met Irene there. And when he came back, he wanted Irene to come back and marry him. So she was 18 years old when she went from Augsburg in Germany and came back, and they were married, but they didn't have just kind of a little civil ceremony. So when the time came for the two of us to get married, Irene had never had a formal wedding. So we decided to have a formal wedding. So we put together a real splash with 150 guests and done up as if we were both virgins. It was a marvelous, marvelous, marvelous wedding. And that was a lot of fun. Well, by this time, John and I were communicating back and forth, maybe a couple of times a year was about all that we were doing. But we knew each other were there, and he was my son, and like that. And Irene had no children. She never had any children. And her father and mother had passed away, and she had no brothers or sisters. So she was alone in this world at the time I married her. And for all intents and purposes, aside from John, I was alone, except for my brothers, of course. But any direct lineage, John was the only person around. And Irene had an assistant that she brought from scratch called Ellen. And Ellen was her protege and turned out to be the assistant manager of the inn while they were there, and turned out to be like a daughter to Irene, and was with me at the time that Irene became ill with uricol cancer. And uricol cancer is so rare that there are only 25 cases of them in the last 35 years nationally. And so we lost Irene, and she's been now gone about a little over 2 years. And Ellen was with us during all of that time, and she became almost like a daughter to me. And I became more than like a father to her, because she didn't really have a dad in her life. Him and his wife had separated for some time, and so she's adopted me as her father, and I've adopted her as another daughter, which I like very much. So she's watching after me, and we have dinner together at least once a month, maybe more often if we can work it out. And she is now the general manager of a huge restaurant in a place called Peddler's Village in the suburbs of Philadelphia, and is responsible for about 130 people. That it's last year they did in excess of $10 million worth of business out of this place, and she made net over $1 million for the company. Big operation, big operation. And that's where it is now. And I look back on it, and I think that if I had it to over again, I would probably have stayed with Dorothy longer. That I felt that I probably didn't give that my best effort. But I do recognize that I loved all of the ladies that I was with, but I was only in love with one, and that's Irene. And I'm still shook over that. Irene came along just that same time. As I say, I'd known for about 25 years, and she was divorced and living alone and living across the fairway in the same neighborhood where we were, and available to date, and I started dating her, and really fell madly in love with her. It's the first time and the only time that I've really been in love. Johnny has always been an independent thinker and actor. And at the time that he finished college here, he was married to a gal, I don't remember her name, but they lived in Chicago. And he decided he wanted to go to Edinburgh, Scotland for his master's. And so they packed up everything that they could carry and sold everything they couldn't carry. And everything that they owned was either in their pocket or on their back, and moved to Edinburgh. And he enrolled. I think he taught English out there for a while before he got enrolled in it. She had trouble finding a place to work because he needed a job in order to stay there, and you know, the same type of thing that we have here, that because you're not from there, you can't get a job. But anyway, she finally found some place where she could work, and they both ended up working. And during the course of that time, the two of them on their vacations grabbed bicycles and toured all of Europe that they could do on that. Well, I always looked at that as more guts than I had ever thought that I would ever have, to pack things up and go into the unknown, because I always wanted it planned and cut and dried and have a reservation made before I did anything like that. But for them to just go off cold turkey, I thought was very good. Well, the result of that, he came back to the States and then divorced that lady and moved up into Alaska. And he had graduated as a political science major. And so with the small towns in Alaska, he became the city manager or the town manager, or whatever you want to call it, and did that. And met Miriam, his present wife, when she was working with one of the banks in Anchorage. And that is his background. Well, John also had a background in building with the VA, with the FHA 203B program, which was for multiple housing for low income, and executed that with most of the places where he was on the in the Alaska area, and then finally moved down to Seattle, where they are now. And that's what he's doing at the present time, is building low income housing for the counties and the cities. And like that around the Seattle suburbs. And his wife Miriam, with her banking background, is actually doing the banking and finding the money for them. And she's so good at it that she ended up placing some $30 million in cash for Gates into a particular bond that paid what he felt the yield was. But her level is that level, to where she had the personal contact with Gates up in that area and did that. So the two of them are working very well as a team. And then he retains the management on these. So he has quite a number of low-income projects that they're managing for the counties and municipalities are doing that. And so I'm very proud of him. He's too heavy, but I can't deny him. He looks just exactly like me. Greg was an athlete, just a pure and simple athlete. There wasn't anything that he wanted to do that he couldn't do in that form. And I remember one case in particular that we went down to Mexico and had a motorcycle in the back seat. And he and his friend, we took two of them down, his friend had one. And they were riding the dunes down in below Ensenada, and just having a ball with it and jumping up in the air and all that kind of stuff. And this one time he was not wearing a helmet and crashed when they lit and got banged up, but not enough to scramble his brains, but he sure scared the hell out of me. Well, I started to get on it to just take a little ride, and he just about went in tears. He just absolutely felt there's no way in the world that I was coordinated enough to ride a motorcycle. And he was probably right, because I didn't do that. In the meantime then, Greg was died in an accident where he fell off of an outside staircase at some park. And it was before CPR was pushed onto everybody. If the CPR had been, he would not have died, because he just had the breath knocked out of him and rolled over on his back and actually drowned in his own fluid, which was a terrible thing. It was just absolutely awful. So I lost him, and he was 15 years old at that time. But he was the one thing that I just did not want to lose when Dorothy and I broke up and they moved back to the Oregon area. And it was in the Oregon area that he had the accident. I've been on the internet. I've been, AOL has the match.com under their love site. And I have tried that. And I went to see a chiropractor for a while because I blew my knee out and was walking funny. And so the chiropractor was helping me put my back back together. And he suggested that I join J-Date, which is the Jewish ladies. And I joined that. And I've been searching both of those sites for somebody. But it's the same old story. I mean, I want somebody younger. I'm searching for somebody between 60 and 70, and I'm 85, and the women I'm looking for somebody younger. It turns out that both men and women want people younger than they are, so it's kind of at cross purposes. And I've had five or six dates, and on two occasions for the second date, and the rest of them has just all been over and out. We got a house full of what I call stuff. And at the time that Irene and Herb closed up the Montgomery Inn, she got a lot of the things that she thought she might be able to use future business or something like that, and brought it over to the townhome that we have. And the townhome is a big town. It's got a huge basement in it. Half of it finished and the rest of it is for storage. So she brought it over. And then when Glory passed away, I sold some stuff and brought the rest of my stuff over and put it in her basement. And then ultimately her previous husband, who became ill, and she and I took care of him for the last 6 months of his life. And he was living in an apartment not too far away that we, you know, helped him with and took him to doctors and all that kind of stuff. And when he passed away, we were given the job of closing up his apartment and bringing his stuff. So we had all kind of his stuff and our stuff and their stuff and all that kind of thing. And so we looked at each other and decided, well, we got to do something with it. And we decided to take it to the flea markets. So we loaded up and we started selling the stuff at flea markets. And there are a number of them around. And in one of those, we bumped into this gal who was selling costume jewelry. I went over and visited with her for a while and bought a dozen or so pins that she thought she might be able to resell at a higher price than what she was paying for it. So we got that, and we turned around and sold those at a profit. And ultimately, we learned from this girl where she was getting her jewelry as at wholesale prices. And she told him about that, and we went up and saw him. There's a distributor up in the New England area that have been doing it for 20 some odd years, manufacturing earrings and buying closeouts. And so we ended up started buying closeouts by the skid. And by that, it would be like a skid full with maybe 30 to 50 boxes of mixed jewelry. And when we brought it back, then you'd have to sort it between the earrings and the bracelets and the necklaces, and grade it whether the price be $15 or $20. And so I had the job of grading and sorting all that stuff. And we were doing a big job, just a big job. We were selling at flea markets 4 days out of the week and spending the other 3 days getting the merchandise ready to take to the flea market. So we were busy 7 days a week and having a ball doing it, because we were doing it together and just really enjoying it. And we were right in the middle of that when she became ill with this damn cancer. So I ended up with a basement full of costume jewelry. And I just finished getting most of it sorted and boxed and categorized. And I haven't run an inventory, but I would guess that I have close to 50,000 pieces of costume jewelry in the basement. I've run the numbers on it, And I've recaptured all of the original cost of all of this. And so that whatever I sell from this point on is like in my pocket as profit. So I've got enough of that to keep me busy for 5 years and at least, you know. And for some reason, I figured the old boy has me programmed for another 20 years and that I'll live to be about 105. You know, and who knows whether that'll happen or not, but that's where I stand right now. And I've made 2 trips out to California by car alone, and one after Gloria passed away, and I was through here and spent about 6 weeks on the road and came back and decided that I wanted Irene in Philadelphia. And when she passed away, I came back out here alone and spent another month touring between here and Seattle to see John and my sister and like that. And came back to Philadelphia and decided that I'm going to stay in the apartment where I am. And it's more peaceful. Isn't quite as many people. And the traffic isn't quite as heavy. It's heavy, but it isn't quite as heavy. So that's just about what I'm going to be doing is that for some period of time. And I'll continue to have an eye out for you know, for another lady, but whether it'll ever happen or not, I just don't know. The longer I live alone, it seems like the more comfortable I get with it, which is counterproductive if you're really looking to for company. And what I miss is going away on a trip and doing it alone. I think it's half as much fun as if you had a companion to be with. But anyway, that's the way the ball rolls. Leo has lived 85 years, and that's a pretty decent philosophy already to have accomplished that. And I really feel that I'm programmed for another 20, and I'm going to go about living it as if God wants me to live for another 20 years. As a matter of fact, John just had his 60th birthday. And we were both born on the same day, January the 18th, 25 years apart. And so I sent him his, you know, birthday. And when he was on here and I was back there. And I said, on your 75th birthday, John, we should plan to be together to celebrate it. You know, I didn't say anything about my being 100 at that time. And I thought that I would get some kind of a response from him. But I didn't. I haven't heard from him on that one. So I'll have to see what, when I see him tomorrow, how he feels about making a date for his 75th birthday. But I think I can be around for that. I mean, I believe that that God is watching out for me. I live with him every day. And I know that we're spiritual. And I know that he's watched after me for this far, and there's something specific that I may never know what it is that he has in mind, but I'll be here. I'm ready. My feeling about life is you just got to keep on keeping on. You know, I bless every day that I wake up and I hit the floor with my feet and I can stand up and walk. I think it's marvelous. I think life is absolutely marvelous.
The colors of the rainbow. deep in the sky are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking and singing, how do you do? They really say, I love you. I hear babies cry and I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than we'll know. And I think to myself.
And I think everybody lives because they have choices. I don't think anything is really preordained, that we all make the choices we want, and we should all be responsible for our actions. And if you're responsible for your actions and you recognize that as you move forward, I think it's all going to turn out good. You know, and that's my philosophy, that I still to this day believe that I'm responsible for my actions and I have the choice to make whether I'm doing this or whether I do that. And I think everybody has a choice of to do this or do that, and that whatever they do, they should be responsible for whatever their action is.
What a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful
That's about it. Fade to black.
No, we fade to colors.